Hachette Audio presents Deviate, The Science of Seeing Differently, written and read by Beau Lotto. This program includes a Mac and PC compatible bonus PDF of supplemental materials. To perceive freely, through tempest, violence uncast with courageous doubt, a tilted self, dedicated to those who walk tilted. Acknowledgments. All knowing begins with question, and a question begins with a quest, to state the obvious. So does life. At the core of living, then, is the courage to move, to step with doubt, but step nonetheless, sometimes off a cliff, which is a less good step. Fortunately, no one steps alone, except that last one. My shuffles, expressed here, were and are enabled by the courage of others, who in different ways enabled me to live. My deviant mom and Padre and Janet, my four mad sisters, my gorgeous gremlins, Zana, Misha, and Theo, and my essential and beautiful co-explorer and creator, Isabel. All incredibly colorful people who have shown me new ways of seeing, sometimes against my will, sorry, always to my benefit, eventually. They are my why, my foundation for attempting to see freely, and the motivation to support others in their attempt to do so. I thank my teachers, and all teachers more generally. Most of our life happens without us there, since most of our perceptions were seeded by, if not outright inherited from, others. Of particular importance to me have been the perceptions of one of the world's leading neuroscientists, Del Purvis, who was the initiator and distiller of my way of thinking and being in science and the science of perception. A mentor in the truest sense, Del, along with Richard Gregory, Marion Diamond, Joseph Campbell, Houston Smith, and Carl Sagan, and their deviating ilk, reveal in action that true science, and creatively critical thinking in general, is a way of being that can transform. They are teachers who show us how to look, not what to look at. Teachers like Mrs. Stuber at Interlake, Mrs. Kniggy Wiggle, Mrs. Marshmallow, Mr. Groom in Orlando at Cherrycrest. Thank you. I also thank my core collaborators, teachers of a different kind, Isabel Benke, who has expanded, opened, and grounded my knowledge personally and academically in essential ways, including the different grounds of Chile, from the kelp beds to lake beds. Rich Clark, who has been core to the lab's activities and ideas since its inception. Lars Chitka, who taught me how to train bees. Dave Strudwick, who was essential to creating the lab's science education program. And my diversity of PhD and master's students in neuroscience, computer science, design, architecture, theater, installation, art, and music, such as David Malkin, Daniel Hume, Udi Schlesinger, and Ilias Burstrom, who became experts in areas that I was not, and in doing so, complexified the lab and my thinking in essential ways. I also thank my highly engaged editors, Moreau, B, and Paul, my brilliant agent and friend, Doug Abrams, whose ambition and impact in publishing is inspiring, and my tremendous support writer, Aaron Schulman, without whom this 20-year project would never have been seen by me, much less anyone else. Together, we struggle to innovate, i.e., to balance creativity and efficiency, or more accurately, they struggle to balance me patiently. And I thank you. One of the most challenging things we can do is step into uncertainty. I conceived of Deviate as an experiment in book form, a place to share my necessarily limited understanding of perception as well as my speculations and opinions, inherited and seeded, in the hope, and I can only hope, that you would know less at the end than you think you know now, and in doing so, understand more. In nature, form or change comes from failure, not success. The brain, like life, does not search to live, but to not die, which makes success an accident of what failure leaves behind when one is thoughtfully deluded enough to walk tilted long enough. The only true voyage of discovery would be to possess other eyes, to behold the universe through the eyes of another. Marcel Proust. Introduction. The Lab of Misfits. When you open your eyes, do you see the world as it really is? Do we see reality? Humans have been asking themselves this question for thousands of years, from the shadows on the wall of Plato's caves in the Republic to Morpheus offering Neo the red pill or the blue pill in the Matrix. The notion that what we see might not be what is truly there has troubled and tantalized us. In the 18th century, the philosopher Immanuel Kant argued that we can never have access to the Ding an sich, the unfiltered thing in itself of objective reality. Great minds of history have taken up this perplexing question again and again. They all had theories, But now neuroscience has an answer. The answer is that we don't see reality. The world exists. It's just that we don't see it. We do not experience the world as it is because our brain didn't evolve to do so. It's a paradox of sorts. Your brain gives you the impression that your perceptions are objectively real. Yet the sensory processes that make perception possible actually separate you from ever accessing that reality directly. Our five senses are like a keyboard to a computer. They provide the means for information from the world to get in, but they have very little to do with what is then experienced in perception. They are, in essence, just mechanical media, and so play only a limited role in what we perceive. In fact, in terms of the sheer number of neural connections, just 10% of the information our brain uses to see comes from our eyes. The rest comes from the other parts of the brain, and this other 90% is in large part what this audiobook is about. Perception derives not just from our five senses, but from our brain's seemingly infinitely sophisticated network that makes sense of all the incoming information. Using perceptual neuroscience, but not only neuroscience, we will see why we don't perceive reality, then explore why this can lead to creativity and innovation at work and love at home or at play. I've written the audiobook to be what it describes, a manifestation of the process of seeing differently. But first, why does any of this really matter to you? Why might you need to deviate from the way you currently perceive? After all, it feels like we see reality accurately, at least most of the time. Clearly, our brain's model of perception has served our species well, allowing us to successfully navigate the world and its ever-shifting complexity. From our days as hunter-gatherers on the savanna, to our current existence paying bills on our smartphones, we're able to find food and shelter, hold down a job, and build meaningful relationships. We have built cities, launched astronauts into space, and created the internet. We must be doing something right. So, who cares that we don't see reality? Perception matters because it underpins everything we think, know, and believe, our hopes and dreams, the clothes we wear, the professions we choose, the thoughts we have, and the people whom we trust and don't trust. Perception is the taste of an apple, the smell of the ocean, the enchantment of spring, the glorious noise of the city, the feeling of love, and even conversations about the impossibility of love. Our sense of self, our most essential way of understanding existence, begins and ends with perception. The death that we all fear is less the death of the body and more the death of perception, as many of us would be quite happy to know that after bodily death, our ability to engage in perception of the world around us continued. This is because perception is what allows us to experience life itself, indeed to see it as alive. Yet most of us don't know how or why perceptions work, or how or why our brain evolved to perceive the way it does. This is why the implications of the way the human brain evolved to perceive are both profoundly and deeply personal. Our brain is a physical embodiment of our ancestors' perceptual reflexes shaped through the process of natural selection, combined with our own reflexes as well as those of our culture in which we are embedded. These, in turn, have been influenced by the mechanisms of development and learning, which results in seeing only what helped us to survive in the past and nothing else. We carry all this empirical history with us and project it out into the world around us. All of our forebears' good survival choices exist within us, as do our own. The mechanisms and strategies that would have led to bad perceptions are selected out, a process that continues to this day, every day. Yet, if the brain is a manifestation of our history, how is it ever possible to step outside the past in order to live and create differently in the future? Fortunately, the neuroscience of perception, and indeed evolution itself, offers us a solution. The answer is essential because it will lead to future innovations in thought and behavior in all aspects of our lives, from love to learning. What is the next greatest innovation? It's not a technology. It's a way of seeing. Humans have the wild and generative gift of being able to see their lives and affect them just by reflecting on the process of perception itself. We can see ourselves see. That is what this audiobook is fundamentally about. Seeing yourself see, or perceiving your perceptions, which is arguably the most essential step in seeing differently. By becoming aware of the principles by which your perceptual brain works, you become an active...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.